Banner, page 779, the Star Spangled Banner, 779. Sunday morning for Memorial Day weekend. Appreciate you all coming out. We get to see some visitors here with us this morning as well, and we hope that you enjoy the services this morning. We pray that you would get something from it as well. And let's go ahead and open in a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for your many blessings. We thank you for your goodness, your love, your kindness, and your compassion to us. And Lord, we pray that you would bless our service this morning as we worship, as we praise, as we preach. Lord, we pray that you would be glorified and that you would be magnified in all that's said and done. And we'll thank you for what you do in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Praise his faithfulness, worship him in voice and all the valleys ring. Come let us sing a song of praise.
Just a couple pages from where we were to hymn number 780. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, hymn number 780. Let's go ahead and stand again as we sing.
America, America,
our theme song, Have Faith in God.
Have faith in God each and every day. Have faith in God every step of the way. Have faith in God when a trial comes. Have faith in God when victory is won. Living by faith in God above. Resting each day in His mercy, His love. Have faith in God as what Jesus said. Have faith, have faith. Have faith in God.
Amen. You may be seated. All right, we've got a few announcements to go over. I have one thank you note here from Paul and Martha Deku. Somebody had given some money toward their travel expenses and designated, or more than one, I don't know, but it says, dear Pastor Ballou and church members, we want to thank you for the $500 towards your travel expenses. We'll always remember all the days we spend together. Your love and your prayers for our family, my wife and son, Paul, who will always be grateful. We prayed so hard for God's choice for a pastor, and God heard all of our prayers. Amen. Keep your eyes on Jesus. We will serve as long as we can. Tell one more soul of God's plan of salvation. The hope of the world is Jesus in Christ, Paul and Martha Deku. And I know they're there in Fiji right now, doing well, and the updates that we're getting, they're getting back into the work there, and so we praise the Lord for His healing for Miss Martha, and just for their being able to get back to the country, and continue to pray for Paul and Wendy, Paul Jr. and Wendy. He's still recovering. I was able to meet up with him at a pastor's meeting a couple weeks ago, and he's doing well, and they're hopefully going to be going over soon. And then, of course, Scott should be bringing his family shortly back there, and then, of course, pray for our own missionaries, Joel and Brooke, and their family as well. So prayer meeting tonight, 5:15. If you're able to be here, we would love to be to have you as part of the prayer meeting. Lord's Supper tonight, and so we'll have our song singspiration service, and then we'll be doing the Lord's Supper, and so make sure you're prepared for that in your heart. Senior Saints prayer meeting Tuesday at 10 a.m., and there's a new call to glory for the month of June on the hall table back here. Then, of course, our Wednesday night Bible study on prophecy, and I've been glad at the number of people that have come out and continued to be faithful for those services, and I'm looking forward to the next few weeks as we continue to teach on prophecy. And of course, our Awana program. I would encourage you, if you know someone with children that doesn't have, you know, a children's program, we were able to invite some couple out this week, a couple of families out this week for Awana. And so just keep inviting people out for that. We'd like to see that grow and the Lord use that. Weekly visitation will be on Thursdays again, and so if you're interested or you're able, let me know so we can make sure we have someone to go with you. I know we've got several families that are going from their home to various areas, and so we appreciate that. And you know, a good thriving church is a soul winning church, and soul winning is not just knocking on doors once a week. Soul winning is a lifestyle. And it's how we live. It's not just, you know, going out on a specific visitation, although that's great, but it's a lifestyle that we live. And one of these days I'll preach a series on that. My wife and I were talking about that last night. We took a walk, and just the things that preachers say over and over and over again that you start picking up on, right? So anyway, and of course, don't forget our graduate reception here in a couple weeks on June 12th after the evening service. There's a list of graduates in the bulletin, and so make sure you are here for that if you can. And then also, we wanted to mention Daniel, Joel and Brooke's son, Daniel. He will not be here, obviously, because they're in Montana. But we will have a table with some pictures and stuff for them, and so we've included him in his graduation because they're members of our church, they're our missionaries, and right. So we want to include them in that, and so be prepared to give him a card with something in it if you can as well, and we'll get all that sent with his Bible over to them as soon as we're done with that right after that, June 12th. Men's cookout Saturday, June 18th. It will be 12 noon at Irvin Park. And there is a sign-up sheet floating around here somewhere. And so let's keep that moving if we can. And that's basically just for those who are able to attend. And then there's a place for you to bring some food. The meat will be provided by the church. And we're going to be having some chicken, and we're going to have some pulled pork sandwiches and some chicken. And so that will be provided by the church. And then we'll be having a cornhole tournament that day as well. And so looking forward to that. If you don't want to be a part of the cornhole tournament and you want to just grab a chair, you know, one of those quad chairs, bring with you, sit around and watch and shoot the breeze, as they say, or there is the river down there. If you're, you know, a fisherman and you like to go fishing and you have a license and you want to come and do that, you can come and go fishing or whatever, you know. So, or if you're, if you're middle age or older and you want to sit on the swing set and swing, that's fine too, you know. Anyway, so there's lots of things that we can do that day. But and then one more time, I want to mention Patriotic Sunday, July 3rd. If you know any first responders, please have them come see us, either myself or Teresa, because we would like to include them in that. If we don't know about them, we can't include them. So make sure you call the church office or come see us about that. And then Cherry Corner Bible Church Camp will be in August. Information is on the hall table. There's registration and information on that. If you're 8 or 9 years old through senior in high school, you can go to Cherry Corner, or there is another camp option. Our girls will be going to a camp about 3 hours away that we know some people at and we've had connection with. And that's actually in June, like the June 20th, I think, through the 24th. And so if you want to be a part of that, either way, please come see us. We don't have a lot of time to prepare anymore for camp. We've announced it a few times. So if you're interested in going to camp and you haven't, said anything, please let us know so that we can, you know, get all that taken care of. There will be here in the next couple weeks more information for camp as far as we're going to do a cookie fundraiser. And so we'll say more about that in the next couple weeks. And so if you have kids that want to go to camp and they want to be a part of the fundraiser, let us know so that we can make sure we handle all that. And then lastly, we will be having a baptism this morning after the morning service, and so praise the Lord for that. And so I hope you can all stick around for that. All right, gentlemen, if you'll come, we'll receive our offering.
Lord, we pause as we enter into this weekend of remembrance, God, to remember those who gave their lives for our country, God. And Father, I just pray you bless, Father, their families, and Lord, help us to, Lord, remember them and remember their sacrifice. And God, thank you for these offerings, Lord. And God, we just pray that you would bless them and you'd use them, Lord, for your honor and glory, God. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you. All right, let's do one more song this morning. Turn to hymn number 781. My Country 'Tis of Thee, hymn number 781. Let's go ahead and stand one more time this morning. Singing, please remain standing for our scripture reading time.
All right, Luke chapter 14, while you're turning there, it's good to have the visitors with us this morning. We always appreciate when people are out of town and they come and come to church, and it's always a good thing to be in the house of God on Sunday, so we appreciate that. Luke chapter 14, we've got a number of people, of our own people, missing out of town as well, so it's nice to have other people fill their spots for the Sunday. So, all right, Luke chapter 14, and we're going to begin reading in verse 25. Luke 14, 25. The Bible says, "And there went out great multitudes with him, and he turned and said unto them, If any man come to me and hate not his father and his mother and his wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. And whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, sitteth not down first and counteth the cost, whether he have sufficient to finish it? Lest happily, after he hath laid the foundation and is not able to finish it, all that behold him begin to mock him, saying, This man began to build and was not able to finish. Or what king, going to make war against another king, sitteth not down first and consulteth whether he be able with 10,000 to meet him that cometh against him with 20,000? Or else, while the other is a great way off, he sendeth an ambassage and desireth conditions of peace. So likewise, whosoever he be of you that forsaketh not all that he hath, he cannot be my disciple." Heavenly Father, we are grateful for the opportunity that we have to be here in the house of God this morning. Lord, we pray that you would just anoint my lips to speak the words that you would have me to say. Help us to listen, to hear, and to be doers of the word and not hearers only. Help us to desire and long to be disciples of Jesus Christ. Well, thank you for all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
torches to the sky, and all who see her know she stands for liberty for you and me. I'm so proud to be called an American, to be met with the brave and the free. I will honor a flag and a trust in God and the statue of liberty. On lowly Golgotha stood a cross, is my Lord raised to the sun, and all who see him live forever as though the saved can testify. I'm so glad to be called a Christian, to be named with the ransomed and whole, as the statue liberates a citizen. So
amen. Thank you, gentlemen. Appreciate that good song. Junior church can be dismissed. I wish I was preaching on the cross this morning after a song like that. Amen. Well, we'll be preaching on Christ, though. How about that? Some songs get you stirred up for something, you know, and you just feel like you got to preach on something specific, I guess. I don't know. And a song like that, man, that'll stir you up to preach on the cross of Christ. Anyway, Luke chapter 14 here, and in our text, I want to concentrate. There are three times that the Word of God says, or Jesus says here, cannot be my disciple. And I want to focus on the third one down in verse 33. The Bible says, so likewise, whosoever he be of you that forsaketh not all that he hath, he cannot be my disciple. You know, sometimes the words that Jesus spoke would almost surprise you at some of the things that he says. In verse 26, he says, if a man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife, and in a few weeks we'll be preaching from that passage. And then he says in verse 27, whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. And we'll talk about that in a couple weeks. But then in verse 33, he says, so likewise, whosoever he be of you that forsaketh not all that he hath. Forsaketh not all that he hath. And he uses the words at the beginning of that verse. He said, so likewise. And so what does he mean, so likewise? Well, what he's dealing with here this morning at this point, as he's talking to this multitude, He's talking about the cost of discipleship. Look with me at verse 28. The Bible says, "For which of you, intending to build a tower, sitteth not down first, and counteth the cost, whether he hath sufficient to finish it? Lest haply, after he laid the foundation, is not able to finish it, and behold, and all that behold it begin to mock him, saying, This man began to build and was not able to finish it." Counting the cost of the tower requires having sufficient money to finish it. Planned in honor of the Scotsman who died in the Napoleonic Wars in the early 1800s, the National Monument of Scotland atop Calton Hill near Edinburgh was intended a recreation of the Parthenon, but a lack of funding left the building only fractionally complete. The project was priced at £42,000 in 1822, but after they raised only £24,000, the project's committee was ultimately only able to afford construction of the monument's foundation and 12 columns. Construction halted in 1826, and the monument has remained unfinished since. And so what Jesus is saying here is, you know, if you begin to build something for a couple years before we moved here, I was in real estate, and several times I looked at houses that were being built or being constructed or even being rehabbed, and somebody ran out of money and couldn't finish it, and therefore they had to sell it. And so we looked at properties sometimes where it was partway finished, and they wanted too much money for it because they wanted what they had into it, not understanding or realizing that it's not worth that by the time you finish it. And so, they would be looking for too much money because they didn't count the cost, or somehow maybe something went wrong in the middle of the project. But Jesus is saying here, he said, if you don't count the cost of building the tower and you don't finish it, then people are going to walk by and they're going to mock at you. They're going to say, what a crazy person. And they may not know the story behind it. Maybe you had a health failure and you had to spend your money on your health. But that doesn't matter to the person walking by the unfinished house. They're still going to mock. And that's what Jesus is saying. He said, you got to make sure you have enough money to finish it. And then he says in verse 31, or what king, going to make war against another king, sitteth not down first, and consulteth whether he be able with 10,000 to meet him that cometh against him with 20,000. So you've got a force twice your size coming at you. Are you a match for that force? You know, counting the cost of the battle requires that you have the proper manpower. And so he says, or else, while the other is a great way off, he sendeth an ambassage and desireth conditions of peace. So you have one large army coming after a smaller army, and the small army says, you know, I don't think we can do this. We're not going to be able to defeat this bigger army, and so let's try to work for peace. Let's try to sit down and have peace talks and try to make sure that, our army isn't destroyed, our people are not enslaved. Let's figure out what it takes to have conditions of peace. After World War II began, Germany invaded and occupied northwestern France beginning in May of 1940. The Americans entered the war in December of 1941, and by 1942, they and the British, who had been evacuated from the beaches of Dunkirk in May 1941, were considering the possibility of a major Allied invasion across the English Channel. The following year, Allied plans for a cross-channel invasion began to ramp up. In November 1943, Adolf Hitler, who was aware of the threat of an invasion along France's northern coast, put Erwin Rommel in charge of spearheading defense operations in the region. Even though the Germans did not know exactly where the Allies would strike, Hitler charged Rommel with finishing the Atlantic Wall, a 2,400-mile fortification of bunkers, landmines, and beach and water obstacles. In January 1944, General Dwight Eisenhower was appointed commander of the Operation Overlord. In the months and weeks before D-Day, the Allies carried out a massive deception operation intended to make the Germans think that the main invasion target was between Pass de Calais, the narrowest point between Britain and France, rather than Normandy. In addition, they led the Germans to believe that Norway and other locations were also potential invasion targets. Many tactics were used to carry out the deception, including fake equipment, a phantom army commanded by George Patton, supposedly based in England, double agents, and a fraudulent radio transmissions. Eisenhower selected June 5th, 1944, as the date for the invasion. However, bad weather on the days leading up to the operation caused it to be delayed for 24 hours. On the morning of June 5th, after his meteorologist predicted improved conditions for the following day, Eisenhower gave the go-ahead for Operation Overlord. He told the troops, "You are about to embark upon the great crusade toward which we have striven these many months. The eyes of the world are upon you." Later that day, more than 5,000 ships and landing craft carrying troops and supplies left England for the trip across the channel to France, while more than 11,000 aircraft were mobilized to provide air cover and support for the invasion. By dawn on June 6th, thousands of paratroopers and glider troops were already on the ground behind enemy lines, securing bridges and exit roads. The amphibious invasions began at 6:30 a.m. The British and Canadians overcame light opposition to capture beaches codenamed Gold, Juno, and Sword, as did the Americans at Utah Beach. U.S. forces faced heavy resistance at Omaha Beach, where there were over 2,000 American casualties. However, by the day's end, approximately 156,000 Allied troops had successfully stormed Normandy's beaches. According to some estimates, more than 4,000 Allied troops lost their lives in the D-Day invasion, with thousands more wounded or missing. Less than a week later, on June 11th, the beaches were fully secured, and over 326,000 troops, more than 50,000 vehicles, and some 100,000 tons of equipment had landed at Normandy. For their part, the Germans suffered from confusion in their ranks and the absence of their celebrated commander Rommel, who was away on leave. At first, Hitler, believing the invasion was a feint designed to distract the Germans from a coming attack north of the Seine River, refused to release nearby divisions to join the counterattack. Reinforcements had to be called from further afield, causing delays. He also hesitated in calling for armored divisions to help in the defense. Moreover, the Germans were hampered by effective Allied air support, which took out many key bridges and forced the Germans to take long detours, as well as efficient Allied naval support, which helped protect advancing Allied troops. In the ensuing weeks, the Allies fought their way across the Normandy countryside in the face of determined German resistance, as well as a dense landscape of marshes and hedgerows. By the end of June, the Allies had seized the vital port of Cherbourg, landed approximately 850,000 men and 150,000 vehicles in Normandy, and were poised to continue their march across France. By the end of August 1944, the Allies had reached the Seine River. Paris was liberated, and the Germans had been removed from northwestern France, effectively concluding the Battle of Normandy. The Allied forces then prepared to enter Germany, where they would meet up with the Soviet troops moving in from the east. The Normandy invasion began to turn the tide against the Nazis. A significant psychological blow, it prevented Hitler from sending troops from France to build up his eastern front against the advancing Soviets. The following spring, on May 8, 1945, the Allies formally accepted the unconditional surrender of the Nazi Germany. Hitler had committed suicide 1 week earlier. Memorial Day, originally called Decoration Day, is a day of remembrance for those who have died in military service for the United States, a day to remember those who paid the ultimate cost for our freedom. I would say, in my mind, that Dwight Eisenhower and his team of men who planned the D-Day invasion
We're successful in counting the cost and understanding what it would take to counterattack the Germans and drive them back in their goal to take over Europe. Jesus said, "What king going to make war against another king sitteth not down first and consulteth whether he be able?" I'm thankful for our history. I'm thankful for our political history, for our military history. I'm thankful that we have a country that we can worship God in freedom. I'm thankful most of all for our religious heritage and our religious freedom and our Baptist forefathers who fought to keep freedom secure and who fought to gain independence, who fought to win the soul liberty battle when the Constitution was written. But Jesus said, in lieu of these two illustrations, that of the military illustration of counting the cost and this building the tower and counting the cost, he said this, "So likewise, whosoever he be of you that forsaketh not all that he hath, he cannot be my disciple." In other words, Jesus is saying there's a cost for discipleship. There's a great cost for discipleship. If you're going to be a disciple of mine, he's telling this multitude, there's going to be a grave cost, and that cost is that you would forsake everything. In today's culture, we look at that and we cringe, and we say, how could God, how could Jesus ask us to forsake everything, to give up everything for Christ? As Christ's multitude of followers grew, he saw the need to give them a glimpse into his life, a life that he had laid down, or that he would lay down, a life that he had given up the splendors and the glory of heaven, a glimpse into his life that he had forsaken everything for us, to let them see what he had lived and what he had preached, to set the stage for them in such a way as to help them understand what it really actually meant to be a disciple. His words would not only be strong, but blunt. And so he gave a vivid description of what was required to be a disciple. His words would surely sting to those who were casual followers and would certainly not be understood by those who followed him for the loaves and the fishes. For you see, to count the cost of what it meant to be a disciple of Jesus meant that you would be willing to forsake all and follow him. To forsake all and follow him. Charles Haddon Spurgeon, on February 22nd, 1874, in the Metropolitan Tabernacle pulpit, said this: "Our Lord Jesus was far too wise to pride himself upon the number of his converts. He cared rather for quality than for quantity. He rejoiced over one sinner that repented, but 10,000 sinners who merely professed to have repented would have given him no joy whatever. His heart longed after the real. He loathed the counterfeit. He panted after substance and the shadow that could not content him. His fan was in his hand with which to thoroughly purge his floor, and his axe was laid to the root of the trees to cut down fruitlessness. He was anxious to leave a living church like a good seed in the land, as free as possible from all admixture. Hence, in this particular instance, one might think that he was repelling men rather than attracting them to his leadership, but indeed he was doing nothing of the kind. He understood right well that men to be truly won must be won by truth, and that the truest love is ever honest, and that the best disciple is not he who joins the class of the great mystery in a hurry and then afterwards discovered that the learning is not such as expected, but one who comes sighing after such knowledge as the teacher is prepared to give. Moreover, our Lord knew that sometimes we may forget that there is no heartbreak in the world to the godly worker like that which comes of disappointed hopes when those who have said, 'Lord, I will follow thee whithersoever thou goest,' turn back into perdition. And when the hot breath which shouted, 'Hosanna,' turns to cruel, cold-blooded cry, 'Crucify him, crucify him.' Nothing is more injurious to a church than a large delusion with half-hearted members, and nothing more dangerous to the persons themselves than to allow them to put on an untrue profession. Therefore, did the master take most care at a time when that care was most needed, that none should follow him under misapprehension, that none should be made fully aware, but should be made fully aware of what was meant by being his disciples, so that they could not say afterwards, "We have been misled. We have been beguiled into a service which disappoints us." Unlike the enlisting sergeant who sets forth all the glories of military service in glowing colors in order to gain a recruit, the great captain of our salvation would have his followers take all things into consideration before they cast in their lot with him. He then gave three statements. First, he said, true religion is costly. Second, he said, wisdom suggests that we should count the cost. And then third, he said, count it whatever it may, true religion is worth the cost. Our scripture this morning says, forsaketh not all that he hath. As if somehow the multitude would understand, he gave to them this vivid statement of being a disciple to forsake all. But you know, 12 men did. Thousands showed up to see the miracles, to see the man, to eat the loaves and the fishes, but 12 left all to follow him. 12 men gave the prime of their life to learn from him and then preach of him. And then 11 of those 12 turned the world upside down for Christ. You see, when Peter was called, when James and John and many of these men, Matthew was sitting at the receipt of custom. He was a tax collector. And Jesus said, "Follow me." And he left all and followed Christ. Peter was in his fishing boat, mending his nets. And Jesus said, "Come on, follow me and I'll make you fishers of men." And Peter, James, and John and others left their nets and left their boats and walked away from their livelihood and said, "I'll follow you." They left it all. They forsook it all, and they turned the world upside down for the cause of Christ. The word forsake means to quit or leave entirely, to abandon, to desert, to give up or renounce, like a habit or a way of life, to forsake. So, dear Christian, dear church, if we are going to be a disciple of Christ, let me give you three things this morning. Number one, you must be willing to give up everything. You must be willing to give up everything. You see, we hold so tightly on to our possessions, do we not? We hold so tightly to that which has absolutely no eternal value. Those things that will be gone in a moment when Christ comes back. But they have a hold over us that cause us to lose focus on eternity and eternal life. But when that is all gone, what will matter will be the eternal, not the temporal. We often live for things that we cannot keep. We work so hard to, pay our mortgage payment, and we work so hard to buy a boat. We work so hard to buy the things that please us in a temporal sense. And there's nothing wrong with the mortgage payment. But if that's what we're working for, if the end is what we can gain, if the end is that we can have a house, if the end is that we can have a boat or have a beautiful car or whatever, if it's temporal things that we're going for, then we've lost sight of what the Christian life is really all about. We must be willing to give up everything. What if Christ were to step in this room this morning and were to take up a time behind this sacred desk we call a pulpit, and he were to ask if we would be willing to give up everything for Christ, for his sake, and to follow him? If Christ himself were standing here saying, "I want you to give up everything. I want you to, today, I want you to follow me, and I'm going to do great and mighty things through you personally, if you would allow me to, if you'll forsake everything," would we in a moment's notice, not even with hesitation, say, "I'll drop everything. I'll drop everything I own. I'll give it away, and I'll come after you, and I'll follow you"? I dare say that probably most of us would not, as did the rich young ruler who came to Jesus. And this rich young ruler was excited because he thought he was such a good person. He thought he had done so much right. He had kept all the commandments, and he couldn't think of any single commandment that he broke. And so he comes to Jesus and said, "Jesus, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said, "Well, first thing you need to do is keep the commandments." Oh, you know, he was ready now. He said, "Well, all this have I done from my youth up." As if somehow Jesus was going to be impressed with the words that he said, but to prove that he was wrong, to prove that he, in his heart and mind, had not kept all the commandments from his youth up, Jesus said, "Okay, one thing thou lackest. One thing thou lackest. Sell everything you have, give it to the poor, and then follow me." Oh, 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 oh. No. Wait. I've kept the commandments. I've done my part. The Bible says he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. We may not have great possessions as far as the standard of what we think. We have great possessions if you look at much of the rest of the world. The vehicles that we drive. A lot of people in some countries in the world don't have a vehicle. They walk. They ride public transportation. They ride a bicycle. They don't own a vehicle and they can't afford one. To be Jesus, this is Jesus' words, not mine. He said, "Forsaketh not all that he hath." Are we not willing to give up our possessions for Christ? You see, true surrender has no hesitation for giving up things. Surrender is only surrender when we leave everything behind. In today's culture, it seems crazy to do what Christ is asking, but it's our culture, it's not Christ. And I understand you say, "Well, Pastor, we have to live somewhere." And I mean, in all fairness, I understand he was talking in a different culture to a different time to different people, but it still applies today. I'm not suggesting this morning, don't misunderstand me, that we go and sell everything and live as nomads. I'm suggesting that we become willing to do that. God, what do you want? But see, rarely do we ever come to that place in our heart and mind where we say, "God, what do you want?" We think about what we want. Oh, wouldn't it be nice to have fill in the blank? Oh man, look at that car, look at that boat, look at that whatever it is. Wouldn't it be nice if we could get that? I wonder, maybe I should pick up another job so that we can do. And what is that job going to do for you? It's going to take you out of church, it's going to take you out of the will of God, it's going to take you away from the things that you should be doing. You know, the truth is, I like having my needs taken care of. I've had a couple people this week tell me I'm spoiled. Did somebody say amen? Oh. My wife left on Tuesday with the girls to go pick up Juliana, and when she left a fridge full of food for me, and she left my laundry all done, and I mean, I'm living the life. And so somebody told me this, "You're spoiled." Yeah, you're right, I am. I mean, we all like having our needs taken care of, don't we? We all like having extra. You know, we like looking at our bank account and saying, "Oh, okay, there's some extra money there. That's great." And there's nothing wrong. Don't misunderstand what I'm saying this morning. There's nothing wrong with having possessions today to take care of ourselves. But when possessions have you, that's where the problem comes in. When those possessions will take you away from God, God should be first in our life. And if we're not willing to forsake all to follow him, Jesus said, you're not my disciple. They're his words. They're not mine. Don't get mad at me. This is what Jesus said. You must be willing to give up everything. Number two, we must be willing to go anywhere. We must be willing to give up everything. This is our possessions. We must be willing to go anywhere. This is our place. In Christ's powerful statement of discipleship, he says, forsaketh not all that he hath. As if losing our possessions would not be enough. This would now encompass us losing our place, our home. Well, why would God ask us to do that? Why would God come to the point of which he would ask us to leave our home and our people and our the place that we live? Why would God ask us to sacrifice that? He asked Abraham. Abraham, I want you to go to a place that I'm going to tell you of. And by the way, I'm not going to tell you until you get there. Well, what direction do I head? Well, just pack up and I'll let you know step by step where to go. Uh-huh. And how many of us would do that? Whoop. I understand it was a different dispensation, right? And so it's a different time. It was the Old Testament. God doesn't do stuff like that. Well, doesn't he? I mean, my family's here, are we not? I mean, I'm not suggesting that I would put myself in Abraham's place, because God called us to a specific place and we uprooted and we came. We left our home. We left everything without the security of knowing where we are going to live and how we are going to live. We just said, okay, God, we'll do it. We'll go. God does it today still. It's not that all of us need to pack up and go. It's that we need to be willing. It's that we need to be willing to say, God, whatever you would have for me in my life, I'm willing to do it, to forsake all that I have. To give up our place, true surrender will always give we'll always place a premium on our willingness to leave our home, our comfort, our convenience, along with our possessions. You know, we would do it for our country, wouldn't we? I mean, you know, boy, 9/11 happened, and oh man, people just, they in droves, they went and signed up for the military. And they don't know where they're going to go. They have no control over it whatsoever. I always loved hearing these young kids say, well, I didn't want to, you know, answer to my mom and dad anymore, so I went and signed up in the military. That'll work real good for you. Do you remember Jonah in the Old Testament? God said to Jonah, Jonah, I want you to go to Nineveh, and I want you to preach to these people. I want you to preach the gospel. I want you to tell them that I'm going to give them 40 days. And if they don't repent and turn from their sin in those 40 days, then I'm going to come and I'm going to destroy them. And Jonah says, no way, Jose. I don't like the Ninevites. I don't like them one bit. I don't like them, Sam, I am. Oh, and so he turned tail and ran. And he gets on board a ship, he gets swallowed by a whale, he gets spit up, and he finally says, okay, I'll go. So he makes a three-day journey in one day, and he gets to Nineveh, and he preaches to the people, fully expecting that they're going to spit at him, that they're going to curse him, that they're going to defy him, and they're going to continue the way, and God's going to destroy him, and he's going to sit down, and he's going to watch God destroy Nineveh. Only something happened. The people rent their clothes, put on sackcloth and ashes, and the people of Nineveh repented. And Jonah was upset because of people that he hated. Talk about prejudice. A people that he hated were going to be blessed by God all of a sudden, and he couldn't stomach it. We must be willing to go anywhere. It took a lot for Jonah to go. Are we willing to go for Christ's sake? Are we willing to go for the gospel's sake? Or are we just going to say no to God? I'm not willing. I'm not willing to do what you want me to do. I wouldn't be willing if you asked me to go. Number three, we must be willing to go alone. Our possessions, our place, and now our people. We must be willing to go alone. The 12 disciples left everything, including their family. You know, we have a hard time with that, don't we? Families want to be together. My wife told me that yesterday as they left the driveway, Grandma and Poppy were sitting there crying. It's hard to leave family, as if somehow God doesn't understand what he's doing, what he's saying, what he's asking. No, he does. So the question comes, could we give up everything for Christ? Could we give up everything for Christ? I'm not talking about giving up everything for this church to thrive. I would never do that. And God doesn't do that. I'm not asking you to give up everything so that other people can live in comforts. God's not asking you to give up everything so that, you know, some people can have a better life. The only reason he would ask us to give up everything, to forsake all, to follow him, to be a true disciple, would be so that the gospel can be furthered, so that we can win the world for Christ, so that we can send missionaries all around the world. I'm not suggesting that we go and sell a bunch of stuff and give it to the missions program. I'm suggesting that we be willing to give up everything for Christ. That in our heart and mind, we could come to an altar and say, God, whatever it is that you want from me, I'm willing to give it to you right now, today. And actually have a heart, not just an outward appearance. You know, we as Independent Baptists for decades have spoken so much and maybe too much to the outside. And we invite people to come to an altar and surrender their life, and that's great. But it's just words. We come to the altar and we say, you know, okay, God, I'll be willing to give up everything. And then I've watched people who have done exactly that. Turn their back within days and not even come close to doing it. A college professor one day, on the first day of the freshman school year, stood up and he said, I want everybody to stand up. So the class stood up. He walked around the room and sat a bunch of people down. He sat three-quarters of the people down in the classroom. And he said to them, this is in a Christian college, he said, the people that are left standing are about 25%. He said, that's who's going to graduate. Not the specific people, but the number. About 25% of you will graduate from the college. Then he went around the room again, and he sat down a bunch more people, down to 1 in 10. And he said, of all of you that are here today, starting out on this journey, 1 in 10 will end up in ministry somewhere. That's shocking. Because what we don't want to do, and Jesus spoke to the multitudes. Verse 25, and there went 8 great multitudes with him, and he turned to them and said unto them, here's a group of people, multitudes, thousands of people. They followed him because they thought he was going to do a miracle. They followed him because they thought they were going to get the 5 loaves and the fishes, and they were going to get a meal out of it. They thought that they were following him so that he could entertain them by berating the Pharisees or overturning the tables in the temple. They followed him, why? Not because they were true disciples. They followed him for what he was going to do. They followed him for the entertainment and the social aspect of it. But 12 men said, we'll follow you. We'll forsake all and follow you. 12 out of a multitude, that's a small number. This morning, what is it going to take for us, for you and for me, to say, God, I want to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. I want to be a disciple of our Lord and Savior. And I'm willing, in my heart, not just my mind, not just my voice, not just the things I say, but I'm actually willing in my heart, God, I'll give it up. God, I'll go anywhere. And God, I'll go alone if that's what it takes. Two great revivals took place in Wales about 150 years ago, one in 1859 and one in 1904. This raised many missionaries for the cause of Christ during that time. And as a result, the gospel reached Northeast India through some of them. The region, which was then in Assam, had hundreds of aggressive tribes called headhunters. Despite severe opposition, the missionaries shared the gospel to these tribes. One shared the gospel to a man, Noxing, his wife and two kids, and they received Christ as their Savior. As a result, many of the villagers began turning to Jesus Christ. Upon hearing this, the chief of the village was angry, and he gathered all of the villagers together. He called Noxing and demanded him to renounce his faith publicly or to face death. Touched by the Holy Spirit, Noxing replied, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. The outraged chief ordered the shooting of his two children. The arrows pierced the boys as they fell dead immediately. Again, he demanded Noxing to deny his faith if he wanted to spare his wife. But Noxing responded, though no one joins me, still I will follow. No turning back. No turning back. His wife died upon their shooting. The chief then asked for the final time for him to deny his faith so that he might live. Noxing gladly said these final words, the cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back. No turning back. He was shot immediately like the rest of his family, but this triggered a mass revival in the village, beginning with the chief. The chief was so extremely disturbed by the faith of this man, he couldn't understand why Noxing, his wife and two children, would give up their life for a man who lived 2,000 years ago in some other continent. So he wanted to experience the remarkable power behind this family's faith. The Holy Spirit touched him, and he cried out and confessed, I too belong to Jesus Christ. When the gathered villagers heard their chief confessing his faith in Jesus Christ, nearly the whole village accepted Christ as their Lord and Savior. And from that experience, the song was written, I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. And in a culture and in a time where we so need God's people, where we so need God's disciples to come forward and say, listen, I've decided to follow Jesus. I'm not going to turn back. I've decided I want to be a follower of Christ, a disciple of Christ, and there's going to be no turning back. I'm going to hold to what I need to hold to. I'm going to stand for Christ where I need to stand for Christ, and I'm going to forsake all if need be so that Christ can be my Lord and Savior, so that Christ can be magnified and glorified, so that the gospel could be preached and people could know of Christ and be saved. It's not for our own glorification, it's not for our own work, but it's for the work of Christ. You see, that which costs us nothing is really worth nothing. The world around us gives trinkets and gifts, and if you do this, you'll get a free gift, and people sign up and give out their information so they can get this free gift, and they'll sign up. My wife did that the other day. We got a $100 gift card promotional thing, and she thought she was calling Penelec to redeem a gift card, and so she called, and it was some other energy company, and then we kind of had to call back and fix all that, and she's like, I'm not sure what I just did, but I did it. And so we follow all the gimmicks, but if it's free, it's worth nothing to us. But if we work for it, then we know it's valuable. The discipleship to which Christ calls us means a life in which his claims must have the preeminence, that Christ would be the one that's magnified in our life, in our body, in our death, and whatever we do in our living. If he's not Lord at all, then he's not Lord. I'm sorry, if he's not Lord of all, then he's not Lord at all. You can't say, well, Jesus is my Lord, God's my Lord, and I put him on the throne of my life. But God, you can't do this, or you can't do that. You can't call me here, you can't call me there, you can't do this with my life. If we count the cost of a full surrender to his claims on our life, then we must also count, and we can also count, on his grace, his aid, and his faithfulness to help us get to the end, so that we may hear the Father say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Father, we are grateful. We are grateful for the opportunity that we have to be a disciple of Christ. Stir our hearts, Lord, to be a disciple. Stir our hearts to be willing to give everything for Christ. Stir our hearts to decide today that we're going to follow Christ no matter what. Lord, give us, Lord, people in this church who are willing to give up everything for Christ, to preach the gospel for the gospel's sake so people can know and hear and be saved. Stir our hearts. Give us a passion for souls. Give us a passion for the lost. Give us a passion for the work of God. And we'll thank you in Jesus' name. With our heads bowed, our eyes closed, would you stand with me? The invitation will be given. If you've never trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, would you come? Take us by the hand and we'll show you from the Word of God how you can know for sure that you're going to heaven. If you're here this morning and you're born again, the altar's open. Would you come and commit and trust your care, your life to Christ? Would you come and would you dedicate yourself to following Christ? The altar is open. Would you come now? For those who need to be baptized, you come, and Brother Brian will come and pray with you here at the altar, and we'll get ready for that. If you're here this morning and you've not been baptized, now would be a good time. Today would be a good time to make that commitment. We can do it another Sunday, but the waters are here, ready to go now.